It's limitless in terms of what instrument you can use, and whether it's like analog audio or a sample or anything. There's no boundary. I love that.
We're Rufus Du Sol,
and this is How We Play Live.
I'm James, one third of Rufus Du Sol, and I play drums in the live show and also do some sequencing, effects-y stuff. And yeah, this is the station, I guess. It's kind of been a trial and error process over the last kind of 9 years of us playing together. Initially, it was just, you know, combining the live kit that we have here and just an SPD. We will have some like stuff that we leave in track, in the drum track, specific clap sounds that we want to, or, you know, specific idiosyncratic like knocks and stuff. But for the most part, I'll play as much as I can possibly. So using the SPD, we can like sample some of those sounds from the record. And then only like a year ago did I kind of have this idea. I thought it'd be really cool to be able to sequence stuff alongside, you know, me playing, and I guess affect it, and, you know, sort of like each night from night to night, make it really obvious by, you know, inputting. So basically I have this Elisa sample pad so I can input sounds that are it's actually triggering this Electron analog rhythm drum machine, and that just felt like a way to keep it interesting, because essentially already, because we're playing live, it feels like from night to night it's something, you know, it's going to be a slightly different iteration of the live show, and it's just felt like another extension to keep it interesting for myself. So essentially, like, I can, so the, this is basically the sounds we have in a song called Treat You Better. So I can like record in like a, and then it's kind of in the loop, and then you can send it through this chaos pad, so I can like, etc., you know. And essentially, yeah, so then from night to night, it can be a slightly different pattern. And it's, we definitely also like the idea that things can be very visually obvious to the audience, so it's not too, like, knob-twiddly, shoegazy, you know. So that's why I felt like it was important that it's, like, input via, you know, something tactile, like playing with a stick. From night to night, I will, like, improvise and sort of feel it out, you know, add, like, a little extra flair or something. And, yeah, I don't know, so it keeps it interesting for me. And there's also like the risk that I might, you know, screw it up or whatever, which I think it keeps it a little bit more exciting for the audience.
Yeah.
And in general, I think that's a good thing about our live show. It's felt like that we put a bit of risk on ourselves to play as much as we possibly can. So this is a receiving clock from Ableton, so then everything can be synced. And we'll use that to sequence other things as well across all the three stations. But this is like very heavily reliant on that. It's just pure acoustic drums, and then we have a really amazing front of house engineer that we tour with, who over the years has dialed in a way to, like, using just his chain and his compression, the sound of the live drums, with to gel them with the sound of some of the, you know, core electronic drums from the record, and like especially the way he's blending the acoustic kick and also the process kick. So we have process kick going, so it means I have to play like extremely tight. It's unforgiving sometimes. This is kind of like the some of the specific, you know, samples and drum sounds from the record that, you know, it feels like it'd be more exciting for me to play it live as opposed to just have it in track. So then, you know, like, sort of thing. So then I can, I'm like playing the hat off the SPD, and then, yeah, so, and that's just, again, a much more tactile way of playing the sounds. And it's very visually obvious, and it looks like, you know, at the end of the day, we're a band, so we want to play as much as we possibly can. The other thing that I find is really interesting is I have this really great Strymon Timeline delay pedal, So I'll, in between songs or even during songs, I'll, you know, set up like weird feedback loops. And then that's just a way to add color. And even during songs, I can, you know, if I'm like, so then I can sort of like just improvise little delayed add-ons during the show, and it keeps it interesting for me, I guess. Yeah. Oh yeah, and also I have this seat which basically has a sub thumper in it, so every time I hit the kick, it like, so I don't need a sub. It's like, it can be invasive sometimes, but for the most part, it's like, it definitely removes the need for me to have like an actual full sub here. And it acoustically, it's much cleaner because then it doesn't bleed into the microphones and everything. So yeah.
My name's Tyrone. I sing and play various synths. My setup's quite simple comparative to the guys. Because I'm singing quite a lot, like I think we all just agreed that me playing the parts is enough, and then I just use the effects within each synth, which is like a nice limitation, I think. And then my pedals here are just, these are for cutoff for both synths, and then sustain. And then I just have a guitar running through here. We don't play a whole lot of guitar in all of our songs, but it's in two or three. It's a really simple setup. We don't have like an amp or anything, so we use the Sans amp, which gives it just a nice subtle amount of drive. I think it sounds good. We have MIDI getting sent if I can't play it or if it's too on the grid, say it's an arpeggiator or something, then we send it. But for the most part, I'm playing any of the parts that I can play. We chose these particular synths because they were the synths. Well, actually, the Prophet 6 was the synth that we used pretty much mostly on the most recent record, on Solace. So a lot of the sounds were already on there. Anything that we'd made while we were recording, we would save them, and you know, it'd be in the ballpark of things that we liked. And while we were recording, we would try and, you know, write down the sound like in the track that we would record so we could come back to it at some point. But there were some that disappeared and we had to recreate some. But yeah, essentially we have MIDI getting sent to do program changes as well. So if there's quick program changes, say in the middle of a song where I have to go from, you know, one patch to another patch, it'll do it in sort of half a second. And I won't have to actually do any of that. So we decided on the Prophet X basically because of the sampling brain in there. I think we intended on using it a lot more basically, but the actual sound of this machine and the samples that were already in its own sort of database, we could kind of flesh out and make things that were close enough to the sounds that we wanted that it was okay.
Hey, I'm John. In the band, I guess all three of us produce pretty evenly in the studio, but when we're on stage, I play the keys, and I've got an SPDSX set up. So just a little bit of percussion. I also play a bit of ride at some point, but that's about it. So the Prophet 6 was a big star of Solace, the OB6 as well, which we're able to sort of mold some of these sounds into sounding like. And I guess the Prophet X as well, like Tyrone was saying before, was intended to have more samples that we couldn't get. But this actually ended up being a bit of a power horse itself with the four oscillators and, or the two oscillators and the two instrument tracks. So it's got like nice piano sounds as well. I often go to like a B patch here and have like, So yeah, I have like A and B levels, and yeah, and using the cutoff for that. Which is, yeah, keeps me on my toes, I guess, just changing between those scenes. But the rest of it, we have program changes coming in to change everything. Like Gobby can be playing like one like verse patch, and then it'll switch straight over and change the sound to my chorus patch, which helps. So this is like a good example of Underwater, a patch that we used on the record. And like James was saying before, we like things to be pretty visual. So we took the big bass sound and put that on the SPSX, so it's nice and visual. And then I'm able to play with my right hand this bit. And then up the glide and stuff as well. And then I also have the chaos pad here, which allows me to do little effects in between. And then all of this stuff is also being sent to this Red Panda little thumb mixer. And then I can send like the SPSX into this like long delay. And it's got a compressor, the delay, and then this Dream Sequencer loop pedal, but it's not working at the moment. But that was supposed to be a bit more fun as well for me, just to mess around with stuff. So yeah, if I send any of this stuff, and then send it to this guy. Yeah, I can mess around with that.
I'm Stefan and I am the playback tech on this tour. These laptops are running exactly the same session. So we've got two Motu ultralights. It's all fairly simple basic gear that we're running here, but each of them goes into a radial SW8, which you can't see, it's around the back. And that's then linked to another two channel switcher. So essentially I've got a switch here. So if one of the computers goes down, I can switch immediately to the other one, which also then switches MIDI going to the stage, because it's one of these things where the playback component of this show is fairly minimal, and so if stuff on stage starts to lose clock or whatever, you know, if Jimbo's doing something on his analog rhythm and he loses clock and then things stop and all that, so it's like imperative that these things can switch over like immediately. We've got a MIDI splitter that's sending MIDI from the Akai MPD 226, and using this really cool little piece of software, which is a Max MSP patch by these guys called Strange Electronic. So it sort of allows you to see all of the every single marker in the set, and then from them you can sort of select which song it is. So we can kind of save things that, so I've got a star next to everything that's current, but say the guys want to go back and be like, oh, if we did that version of, you know, Underwater where we had the extended thing or whatever, then we can quite easily find those things and bring them up, which, you know, sometimes with these festival sets, you've got an odd length sort of time slot and you've got to figure out how to fit into that well. Yeah, so this is a really cool bit of kit. So now it just means that essentially it comes up on both computers. I usually have them so I can see the thing. We just got to make sure that the set list is the same, and then yeah, just kind of ups and downs to select the song. You press play, and it's kind of foolproof, because in the past you'd sort of use one of these sorts of triggers with a button for each song. I've definitely had that where, you know, someone, particularly in smaller venues, some drunk punter touches something and it triggers the wrong song, and then it's all in arrangement view. Yeah, so you'll see. I mean, look, this session is enormous. You'll see all of those different things there. But, you know, the laptops run it well. Cassian, who mixed the record, has also mixed all of the playback stuff here. So it basically should be coming out of here sounding ready to go for the monitor guy and the front of house guy. So they get that and they just sort of set the faders at zero and go.
the moment. I think people are really wanting to be entertained by true performances, and there's been no better time than now to be able to combine electronic music with live performance, and that's something we've always been so intrigued by, and we try to dance between in the studio and just moving in and out of that line between like what's organic and what's like, you know, electronic.